Welcome to another edition of our live Pittsburgh Sportsline TV show. Thanks for watching us. We're in the studio here in Bethel Park, right in the municipal building where the library and the police station are. So come out and see us sometime, but that's where we're producing our show today. I'm Al Levine, the talking machine. I got Chip Hayner right with me. Smoking Jim is still on the injury reserve list. We don't know what's wrong with him. He sent me a text that he's getting better. I have no idea what that means because I don't know what was injured. I don't know what happened to him except his car was totaled and he was in the trauma unit for 3 days. So it's the man of mystery.
And my question would be better than what? But
well, he did put that in there, one of his texts. I text him every day, how are you? Don't lie to me too much, still praying. One of the first texts that he sent back to me is, I'm better than I was on Tuesday. Well, Tuesday was when he was in the accident. So that's what the what is. He's better than that.
There you go. So that's progress is
yes.
What we got.
Well, this has been a couple weeks now, so we'll see what happens, and we'll just keep moving forward. Just send your prayers for Smoking Jim. Keep praying for Smoking Jim, my brother from another mother. I pray every day for him, and hopefully these prayers will be answered and he'll be back with us as soon as he can. Although he did tell Chip it'd be a while, he did tell me it'd be a while, and he had to go to rehab. I don't know what he's rehabbing. So the man of mystery keeps us alive, and we'll just take it for what it is. He's a great guy, best smiles in the media, one of the nicest guys you'll ever meet, and we'll get him back with us hopefully soon. So I have some promos here. I'm not sure if they need to come in here and give me some guidance here, but should I just put this up, Zach, for what camera to peek at this, buddy? Can we get a close-up on that? We got Jack and Zach working on this. They're unbelievable. The dynamic duos here from Bethel Park TV.
Yeah.
Look at that. 412-831-1900, Olive Oils Pizzeria at Hillcrest Shopping Center. Give them a call. They sponsor our show with a large, extra large pizza and a steak hoagie, and they were delicious tonight. We appreciate that. They're our sponsor of our show. Next, we have Stay Joey Strong. We end every show with Stay Joey Strong. Here's Joey before DIPG, after DIPG, he died before his ninth birthday. They've raised over $100,000 the last 4 years to try to find a cure for this dreaded brain cancer, DIPG. Go to the Joey Fabus Childhood Cancer Foundation. They're a 501c3. Donate what you can, a dollar, anything. They have an event coming up at the community center, May 17th, Night at the Races. $20 to get in. Excuse me, all kind of baskets, activities. You can even get your own horse for $10. If it wins, you get $40. So you can help a good cause and win some money. Check it out. Next, Bethel Park Historical Society Arts and History Center, 2600 South Park Road. You can't miss it with the big trolley. The old time trolley's right outside, red trolley. It's right there. They have different places that rent from them. They have different activities and events there. Check it out. They're a 501c3, the Bethel Park Historical Society. And Bill Habether had broke his ankle and he's healing up. So when you see him, tell him I said hello. All right. Dave Cable likes to have a little fun at my expense. He put my face on Uncle Sam. Tell them Uncle Al wants you for BPTV. You could be like Zach and Jack, the dynamic duo here tonight, running the sound, running the video, adjusting cameras, eating pizza, talking to us, everything. 412-831-3304. Give a call and say you want to be a volunteer here and on location when we're filming out and about in the public. There's lots of different shows. Dave runs about 500 shows a year out of Bethel Park TV, so it's a pretty prolific station. Next, we have the Bethel Park Community Foundation. They're a 501c3 bpcf.org. Get an application. They have money for you from $100 to $5,000 for you. and your group. If you're doing great things in Bethel, they can help sponsor your group to do even more things. So check it out, bpcf.org. Get an app. I'm one of the trustees on the board. There's 26 trustees. Come on out and tell us what you do. Next, we have a sponsor that does for what's on your mind, Skeets Lewandowski of Skeets Service Station. You guys can adjust the camera back to that number one camera if you can. There we go. And you can call Skeets at 724-348-4715. Anything and everything that runs on gas, he can fix. You name it, boats, trucks, cars, weed whackers, lawnmowers. Did I even met tractors? I've seen that. Big trucks, little trucks, you name it. If it runs on gas, they'll fix it.
Tonka trucks.
No Tonka trucks. They'll bring one out and play in, you know, in the garage, but no, that's about it. But anything that runs on gas, they work on it. So check them out. 7 miles from my house in Bethel Park, right past Trax Farm and Mineral Beach. Red, white, and blue station. Can't miss it. All right, we got a lot of sports to talk about like we always do, and we start our show off with what's on your mind, Chip Hayner.
Well, thank you, Alan, and good evening, everybody. And what's on my mind, even though I'm a little off-center here, but that's okay. I'm a kind of an off-center kind
adjust
of guy.
Adjust this camera, guys. No, come on.
But anyhow, what's on my mind? How to put this, what's on my mind is...
Perfect. Thanks, Jack.
I think I'm going to come out on the side of... I am not a fan of instant replay.
Whoa.
The NFL has recently, because of an egregious blown call in the NFC Championship game, which sent the Los Angeles Rams as the sacrificial lamb to the New England Patriots in the Super Bowl, we've made a rule change in the NFL, and this is going to dovetail out into something else that involves Major League Baseball as well. But, you know, I think what we have done with instant replay is I believe that we are starting to ruin the game of football, and even they're attempting to try to make this into ruining the game of Major League Baseball, you know. And here's what my thoughts are. I hear the argument all the time is we just want them to get the calls right. Well, you know what? Games are played by human beings, and human beings have flaws. And games are refereed by human beings, and referees have flaws. And it's been a part in the fabric of every one of these games since their inception. I don't understand why we want to take the humanity out of officiating games or even out of playing the games. You know, what the NFL has done is they have passed a new rule where now pass interference, or as they call it, OPI or DPI, you know, why we got to come up with acronyms for it is beyond me. But offensive pass interference and defensive pass interference, they're now going to be reviewable plays where even if a call wasn't made, it can be reviewed. Which, I mean, it sounds great if you're New Orleans Saints fans because, you know, there was no call made on the play that the referees obviously blew. And it's not the first call that's been blown, and even in a major championship game in the history of the NFL. Right. They're part of the history of the NFL. Steelers benefited from one in 1979 against the Houston Oilers. But here's where I feel that they made a huge mistake. Why is it that you can review offensive pass interference or defensive pass interference, even if it wasn't called? What about holding, for example? How many running plays where a guy runs 50 or 60 yards for a touchdown were the result of a holding call that wasn't whistled? Sure. So if we're going to allow them to call pass interference, why not holding? Why not review every play and penalize every infraction? Because it would take 3 days to play a game, and it would ruin the sport. And I think what they should do is just go back to the way things were done and have been done for decades and decades. You know, in this age of high definition TV, you know, we slow down the film and everybody can sit there. You know, these calls are made made in split the blink second. Of an eye. Blink of an eye, okay? And, you know, you make your call, you stand by it. And that gets me to Major League Baseball. You know, yesterday I was at the Pirates home opener. And, you know, it was a great atmosphere, great tribute to the Tree of Life victims, to the first responders that responded, to the officers that put themselves in harm's way, trying to save people from a madman, for lack of anything better. Great atmosphere, opening day, you know, everything, the fanfare that goes with it and everything. And the umpire behind the plate was, he was doing a pretty bad job of calling balls and strikes. And, you know, complaining about the ump, that's part of baseball. I've been doing it ever since I was a child.
You picked up a bat and did it.
Yeah, you know, they've been doing it since baseball became a game. 150 years ago, people have been complaining about umps ever since. And people talk about wanting to get a computer in there to call balls and strikes. And I think it would be the worst thing that they could ever do to the game of baseball. You know, one of the beauties of baseball is the strike zone is really kind of a gray area.
Yeah.
It's a gray area. Each ump looks at the strike zone a little bit differently. And, you know, so the players adjust from game to game. You know, I do believe that, you know, all of the game stoppages for reviewing plays, you know, not only does it embarrass the umps, but it takes away from the flow of the game.
Sure,
and if they want to try to speed up the games, you know, maybe... you know, this is something that they should just do without. I mean, hey, whether you agree with it or whether you disagree with it, we're all humans, we're all flawed, and, you know, why not just let the flaws stand where they may? I mean, you know, why try to change things now? And my point being is, if people are so interested in wanting to get it right, you know, and you want to play your Xbox, but keep it out of the baseball stadiums, keep it out of the football stadiums. You know, if you want perfection, play Madden, okay? You can do that. But when we've got games being played by human beings and being refereed by human beings, the calls, just let them fall where they may. Sometimes they go for you, sometimes they go against you, but in the end, it usually all evens out. But that's what's on my mind this week.
Oh, Chip, you're... speaking to the son of a referee, my dad studied the rule book in basketball like nobody's business. I've shared it a few times, and coaches would call him, players would call him, referees would call him, get his interpretation of the rules in the rule book, and they're all standard, and you can read it, but then when you see the plays, you're on one side or the other. It's what your perception of it is,
mm-hmm.
and what actually happened. They're like two different things. It's like they talk about witnesses. You could have 50 witnesses in 50 different scenarios.
Yeah, you have 50 different stories.
So
all of them differ slightly.
Look at the millions that watch sports.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I take it as. I got to agree with you. I'm more of a purist with the football and baseball. I'd like to see it, you know, back to the original way with a lot of that.
Yeah.
A lot of the drama and other stuff.
It takes away. I mean, yesterday, a five-hour baseball game. Now everybody wants to scrap the whole baseball. Say, the game's broken. We have to fix it. No, the game's not broken, okay? Yesterday was an extremely long baseball game. I don't like five-hour baseball games. I'm much happier at a game that's played by, you know, somewhere between 2 and 3 hours. But you know what? You have those from time to time. You know what you do? You bite the bullet and you move on.
My son asked me one question when I said that Chip was going to the game with his wife and we're watching the game and it's like 3.5 hours in. He goes, is Chip still there? I go, he'll be there till the end.
Hmm.
We're 4 hours into it. He goes, is Chip still there? I go, yeah, it's almost 5 hours. The game's finally over. I'll get into what's on my mind because I'm going to talk a little bit about the Pirate game because I like openers and things like that. But, yeah, I told my son, I said, Drew, he'll be there at the end of the game.
You know, so. I mean, I pay to get in. I want to watch the game completed. I mean,
and you just, got your money's worth.
Yeah.
That's what we both said.
Yeah, we sure did. But, hey, you know, it's opening day. You know, Saturday's game. It's going to be short and sweet and a Pirate victory.
There we go. I like your optimism. All right. What's on my mind is we already let into a little Bucco talk. I used to skip school with permission and go to the games. I remember doing that for many years. as a teenager, and it was fun. Always enjoyed it. Went to the different games at Three Rivers Stadium and just had a great time. Haven't been to an opener in years, but I watch them on TV. And I was watching it those first five innings. A lot of pitches were thrown, but I think the trade for Archer is a good trade right now. Because he's striking out, what do you have, eight strikeouts.
He said, you know, three or four walks. Yeah. Threw a lot of pitches in five innings, 99 pitches.
99 pitches. It was a little extreme. But he did have a decent, you know, start, which that's what we wanted to see as Pittsburgh fans. That's why they made the splash trade and got him. So it shows that he's back, he's recovered, and he can pitch, and he's known for his strikeouts. So, okay. Now we go to the relief. I'm not going to talk too much about it. I could just say I'm disappointed. I can talk a little bit about the shortstop who I kept hearing all these great things, but I saw him in spring training, and they said he was pressing. Well, I thought he was just making errors and misplaying the ball because I saw a few of his errors in the, you know, in the spring training. So I gave him the benefit of doubt. They said he earned a job because he plays with a glove like nobody's business. Well, I saw he doesn't play like nobody's business with the glove. He made an error that was a costly error and should have never happened with a guy of his so-called caliber. I mean, he's a 27-year-old man. Sure, he's been on the bench, but he supposedly had all this talent there out in the field. Well, time will tell. One game doesn't make a season. There's still 160-some games to go, so I'll wait to see them. But it's not a good sign on what I did see. And Vasquez was lights out in spring training. I don't know what happened to him. Now he's thrown 25, 30 pitches and giving up some monster doubles here and things. So he'll get back because he can do it. He's got the arm. He's got the four pitches. It's just a matter of a long season seeing them produce. But it was frustrating watching that game. Luckily, I wasn't there in the cold or the shade or the sun or the breeze and didn't get that enjoyment also. But it was a frustrating game to watch, especially when they were up 4-0. And then they pittered it away and ended up losing 6-5. So there's better things to come, but that's what was on my mind, the opener. We lost the opener. So we'll build on it from here. We're going to be back with Chip's Trivia Time.
Just in making home movies, me and some buddies would just grab a camera and you just start making these videos, and then you realize at some point that this isn't just a hobby anymore, it's something that you actually want to pursue, and there's this great facility right down the road, BPTV. A lot of people will try to do these productions on their own, and one of the things they don't have is the equipment, you know, but right here is everything that you need in one nice little bundle. There's lights, cameras, reflectors, dollies, all kinds of little knickknacks, like anything that you'd want to use that you would need for a production, you have it right here, like it's all right here. You can make your own feature movie just with the stuff from this studio. Come meet Dave Cable, let him show you around, and I think you'll realize that this is something that you could fall into regardless of your level of expertise, whether you're a beginner or even if you're a more advanced learner. There's something here for everyone, and I feel that you just need to come through and just be a part of the experience and just watch and learn, and you know, let Dave be your guide.
One of the things we do at BPTV is encourage our producers to film on location. Not only does shooting on location give our producers the opportunity to take advantage of their subject matter, filming in different locations gives each program its own distinct flavor. This also helps anyone who's flipping through the channels avoid confusion when they turn on BPTV. With around 500 programs produced at BPTV each year, the last thing we want people to think is that we're only broadcasting one program. So, you need to come into BPTV to pitch your TV show. But in terms of where you actually end up taping your show, the sky's the limit.
Welcome everybody and good evening. And well, we've got a lot of things going on in baseball. We had opening day with the Pirates yesterday and opening day across the sport of baseball. So once again, it's the best time of the year.
For you.
Baseball season. But also, one of the things, we also had some other significant sporting events this past weekend that do need to be brought to everybody's attention. Number one, we went from the Sweet 16 to the Elite Eight all the way down to the Final Four. And if anybody wonders why I love the NCAA basketball tournament, look at what we've got in the tournament left. There's the one number one seed that nobody picked to go to the Final Four made it. The team everybody picked that to win the national title.
Including me.
With the greatest college basketball player that's ever graced the game.
Yes.
Okay. Got bounced. You know, another one of the favorites, Kentucky, got bounced. And
at Calipari just signed a huge contract.
Oh yeah, he doesn't have to win to get paid more money in a lifetime contract. So you know, we've got the Final Four coming up this weekend, and I'm going to go ahead out on a limb, and I'm going to pick my. My winner right now, I'm saying Texas Tech, the Red Raiders.
Wow.
I believe that they're going to do it. They got Paul Mahomes running, rooting for his alma mater. So that's what my pick.
Good karma.
I'm going to go back over some memorable moments in NCAA basketball tournament history.
All right.
Okay. And I've got some, some of these events here. We'll start with in 1984, Georgetown was led by Patrick Ewing, and they won their first national championship. Which school did they defeat 84-75 in the championship game? Ooh. It was the University of Houston, Phi Slamma Jamma, with Clyde the Glide Drexler and
I remember that
and Hakeem Olajuwon. They had a stacked team, but this weekend I think Michigan State shows what happens when you play well together as a team, instead of having a team built around a superstar. The better team always wins.
Yeah.
Number two, in 1992, this is a classic moment, one of Duke's shining moments.
Whoa!
In the 1992 East Regional Final. Christian Laettner hit the game-winning basket from the top of the key with 1 second left to lift Duke to a 104-103 win. And what team was their opponent? That was the University of Kentucky.
Wow.
Who was the loser against North Carolina in 1993? It would have been East Carolina, North Carolina and East Carolina. In 1995, UCLA won their first national championship in 20 years when they won 10 out of 12 from 1964 to 1975. Who was the loser for that year? We're talking about losers now. That was the University of Oklahoma.
Mm.
But UCLA did something that will never be done again. But back then, You weren't allowed to play as a freshman, so Lou Alcindor only won 3 MVP awards, because
he couldn't play, and
Bill Walton,
they were limited.
They were limited, and I think the game was better than it was now. I'm not a huge fan of one and done. I don't think a college basketball program should be able to use a scholarship for an athlete that has no intention of getting his degree. I think the scholarship should go to somebody that actually wants to earn a degree and make something of himself. I think it's a disservice to just
Well, hence
student athletes.
I was just going to say the student athletes, what it's about.
So yes, that's what it's about. And now they're talking about that the college basketball player, or that college athletes should be paid. Well, you know what? I disagree. I think they're getting paid well enough by having all of their school and boarding paid. But I mean, nobody sees that as being worth anything monetary.
Right.
The first team to lose in the 64-team format.
Whoa.
In the 64-team format, 1985 was the first year the NCAA tournament did that. Villanova defeated Georgetown to become the first national champion in the new format. The first loser of that tournament was the University of Marshall.
Wow.
I'm going to go take you all the way back to when I was just a wee lad. Okay. Kentucky was stunned by which all-African-American starting lineup in the 1966 National Championship.
I've heard about it.
Yeah, and the university is now known as something other than it was then. The name of the university was Texas Western, and that university is now known as UTEP. Okay. The very first Final Four was played in which Midwestern city? And the answer to that is Evanston, Illinois.
Wow.
And that was back in 1939. That was even a few years before Al Levine.
Yeah, before I knew.
Yeah. Maybe his dad was refereeing that game.
No, and he was only 8 years old then.
Okay. And then what was the site of the first NCAA championship game? It was Patton Gymnasium in Evanston, Illinois.
Wow. Interesting stuff here.
Yes, there are some interesting things. Okay, this one, and I know this one's for my dear friend Jim Frazier. Which team from the 1980 Final Four were known as the Doctors of Dunk?
Oh.
And I will give you a nickname for the top athlete on that team. They called him Dr. Dunkenstein.
Oh, I remember this.
Daryl Griffith of the Louisville Cardinals. Dr. Dunkenstein.
Wow.
They won the Cardinals' first national championship.
They could dunk.
Oh, yes, they could.
They were something else.
Let's see here. Okay, and going back to 1985, first year that the tournament went to the 64-team format. Who was the lowest seeded team to ever win the national title? And that, if we go back to 1985, we know that Villanova beat Georgetown. Villanova was a number 8 seed. They are the lowest seeded team to win the national title. Okay, let's see here. Okay, see you're going to have to bear with me, folks.
Yeah.
Some of these things, they don't make sense to me. They give me a question and then an answer, and it just doesn't seem to
make much sense. Go to the next one.
Yeah, I don't want to. Yeah, I'm going to the next one quick. In 1991, second-seeded Syracuse was spider-bitten by a shocking first-round defeat. Who beat the Orange Men?
I don't know.
The Richmond Spiders.
Wow.
The Richmond Spiders.
You were teasing me with the name. Yeah. Some of these nicknames will get you.
Okay, let's see here.
Find a good one.
This team did not lose in the Final Four the year after winning it all. They could have won it all and lost at any other time in a tournament or not made the tournament at all. And the answer was 1989 Michigan.
Whoa.
They lost to the Hoyas lost to Villanova in 85. Okay, they had, and once again, they've confused
me. It's
convoluted. Okay. Okay, what city has hosted the most Division I championship games in the 20th century? Now, remember, this is in the 20th century. So we're in the 21st century now.
Atlanta.
Kansas City.
Wow.
Kansas City.
The middle of the country.
And who is the only team, or let me say it this way, who was the last undefeated team to win the NCAA title?
You got me.
That was the 1976 Indiana Hoosiers of Bobby Knight.
Whoa.
The last undefeated team, John Calipari, came close
ago.
A couple of years, yeah. And he lost in the championship game. And that is quite an amazing statistic.
That's a heck of a run, yeah.
But in 1985, Villanova studs Georgetown by winning the Final Four. And in which city the Wildcats beat the Hoyas in Lexington, Kentucky.
Wow.
So just some interesting things about the NCAA basketball tournament. I want to tell you something. Saturday night, we've got the Final Four. And if you want to watch some of the best basketball that you'll see all year.
Turn it on.
I watch this because I'm almost willing to bet that the championship game will be somewhat anticlimactic.
Sure.
You know, but there's
you'll see some good basketball.
You know, Virginia, Texas Tech, Michigan State, and the Auburn Tigers. Can you believe Auburn?
No.
Shut down Kentucky, heavily favored Kentucky, as did
look what they did to North Carolina.
Yeah. Well, they, you know, to make it this far into the tournament, you know, you had to beat some good teams. You know, one of the things I love about the NCAA basketball tournament is, you know, you've got to win six games to win the championship. So, you know, anybody can win one, you know.
Sure.
But to win six and you're playing six different teams, you're not playing a best of six series against the same team where you get to know their tendencies. You're playing a brand new team that you've got one day to prepare for.
Sure.
So it does make it a little bit more interesting. But there you go. Enjoy the Final Four this weekend, and we'll carry on from there.
All right. Thanks, Chip. Appreciate all that information. Welcome back. That wasn't long at all. I have an on-location show at the Oaks Theater Friday night. I'll be interviewing Sid Bream. I got confirmation Sid will be there. The show will start at 7:30. That's the Oaks Theater in Oakmont. They got a bar, restaurant area, bar food, so there's plenty to eat and drink. And enjoy the Talking Machine interviewing Sid Bream. 45 minutes first, 15-minute break. Then 45 minutes with a Q&A period at the end of the next 45-minute session. So it should be a fun night. Come on out there Friday night. That's this Friday night, April 5th. I'll see you out there. That'll be on location there. Then Monday, we'll be back at Olive Oil's Pizzeria at 930 Brookline Boulevard, 7:30 to 8:30. Got a bunch of guests coming in. Pittsburgh Defenders Arena League football team. Got some Jose Carabella, boxing trainer, Ray Schaefer boxing gym, Colleen Davis, three-time Golden Glove champion. She'll be there. Rachel Rakovin, Miss Pennsylvania beauty queen, and Green Energy Party. She'll be talking to you and a few other guests too. Come on out, enjoy the great pizza, hoagies, salads, you name it. They even have pasta specials, different food specials out there. Frank Finera sponsors us and puts on a great meal. So you'll hear great sports talk and get to enjoy some great food. See you on Monday the 8th. All right, we'll be back with some Bucko talk to finish the show and some Penguin talk, of course, because it's that time of year. We'll see you shortly. From a very young age, I was exposed to sports in a great way. My uncle was on the first pro basketball team in Pittsburgh, the Pittsburgh Ironmen. And my dad, of course, that was my hero. He was a basketball referee for over 30 years. Just been a passion in my life. And as I got older, I found out about horses and I ended up owning a stable. And I was asked to be on a sports show with Roger Houston called the Meadows Racing Network. And when we were done, I said, boy, that'd be something great. Maybe someday I could have a TV show. back in 2011, I had a conversation with some friends about sports that piqued my interest in how could we start a sports talk show on TV? Well, I found out I could go to public access TV in Bethel Park and I'd be able to produce my own sports talk TV show. The great thing about doing two sports talk shows on BPTV is I can share my passion about sports with thousands of people every week. If you are passionate about something that you would like to share with the community, I encourage you to come to BPTV and produce a show like I do. I'm Al Levine, volunteer producer of Pittsburgh Sportsline on BPTV. Hi, Bethel Park. Uncle Al speaking. I'm asking you to come help us behind the scenes at BPTV. We're looking for some proud Bethel Park residents to help us make the shows that you want to watch. For more information, contact Station Director Dave Cable, and we will see you behind the cameras at BPTV. Welcome back, Bucko Talk.
Welcome back, Bucko Talk. Pirates have played three games this year. You know, one thing about the baseball season is a marathon. It is not a sprint. And the Pirates have stumbled a little bit coming out of the gate. One of the things that we thought were going to be one of the strengths for the team has proven to be so. The starting pitcher has been fine.
Yeah.
The middle of the bullpen has been kind of suspect, and most specifically Rich Rodriguez.
Yeah.
He's been put into two games, and in two games he's given up two home runs that have
Has he even got anybody out?
Keone Keller has performed well, and Felipe Vasquez seems to be just a little bit off. And just before anybody else decides, you know, get your finger off the panic button, remain calm, all is well. And I think that Eric Gonzalez made a bunch of what I would consider rookie mistakes yesterday in the game. He misplayed a couple of balls in the field. One of the most frustrating things that I saw, and, you know, you had your starting pitcher, Chris Archer, pitched his whole career in the American League. You know, so he batted a handful of times in his career, and he laid down a beautiful sacrifice bunt yesterday, yeah, right in front of home plate. Gonzalez was on first. He makes it to second, and in his exuberance, ran 20 feet past second base and got caught between second and third and got picked off. And what should have been, you know, we could have had potential the ability to score another run. we turned a potential positive inning into a negative. Now we're at two outs with nobody on. And, you know, these are the kind of mistakes that you're going to get out of a young team. And, you know, and it's so funny how everybody on the talk radio and everywhere else is everybody saying the Pirates should have done this and they should have done that. But you know what I heard about them? The same people about the Pirates team before last Thursday, crickets. I didn't hear anything. Nobody, you know, everybody was just quiet. They weren't saying anything about them. Now everybody knows what the Pirates should have done, could have done. What, you know, here's what: the Pirates are going to have a team that's going to win a lot of games this year. They're going to make some mistakes, and you know what? That's the game of baseball.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, I heard an interesting statistic that the teams in the as badly as the Pirates played in the field yesterday, There are teams in the major leagues that have a far worse fielding percentage than the Pirates do.
Whoa.
Let me just give you the names of some of these teams. The Boston Red Sox.
Wow.
The New York Mets. The New York Mets already have 13 errors for the season. The Los Angeles Dodgers, the San Francisco Giants, the Seattle Mariners. Okay, so these are all teams with $150+ million payrolls, but how could that possibly be? They're all in. Their ownership wants to win. They're paying all the money in the world, yet people still make errors. Yeah. It's the game of baseball. You know, and I'll tell you this. If you've ever played the game of baseball and you play on a cold day, you know, funny things happen.
They used to tell us we're not practicing if it's 50 degrees or lower.
Well, you know what?
That's what they told us growing up as a kid in the 60s.
Well, you know, when they're playing games and it's 30 and 35 degrees.
That's my point.
You know, one of the points.
The high's 44.
I was watching Sunday's game. And I was watching Francisco Cervelli, and he fouled off a ball. And he's sitting there going like this. And my wife says, why is he? And I said, when you hit a baseball with a wooden bat and you do not hit it on the sweet spot, it stings, okay? And that's the way it is in the cold weather. You got to shake it off. So, you know, I mean, these kind of things happen. And, you know, I think the Pirates are going to be fine. Adam Frazier's going to start hitting again. And everybody's just gotten off to a little bit of a slow start. Everybody has already written the epitaph for Josh Bell. An unnamed scout. I love these.
Anonymous there.
An anonymous scout has said that Josh Bell is worthless. He's a lump. He isn't going to do anything. And one of the things that the nicknames they've given Josh Bell, and they call him Tinker Bell. And it's not because of what most people might think, just because he's always tinkering with his swing. And one of the things that Clint Hurdle sat him down and told him to do, he's like, look.
Stop.
Pick one and just stick with it, okay? Constantly trying to change what you're doing. You're never going to get into a rhythm. Josh Bell is already starting to produce RBIs, even though he hasn't hit any home runs yet. And I think he's just going to be fine. He is never going to be a gold glove first baseman, but if he can hit 25 to 30 home runs a year, which is what he did in his rookie season,
26.
He is going to be worth having on that field every day. Colin Moran yesterday was we're going to call him the Pirates home opening legend, because in two Pirate home openers, he has 7 RBIs.
Yeah.
He had a grand slam last year. He hit put us in the lead with a home run yesterday, but he also got 2 RBIs in the first inning with a double. But, you know, Colin Moran will prove his worth to this team over the course of the season because he can back up at first base.
Yeah.
And
there's some flexibility.
And he can play third base, even though Jung Ho Gung is a better fielder. And that one point couldn't have been brought out more.
One play he made on fielding the ball and the bad throw to second base.
Well, and I was thinking more of the ball that was hit right past him.
Yeah.
And, you know, and it was hit sharply, but it was a play he didn't even have to move.
No.
And he just flat out missed it, you know.
Yeah.
And
that too. I didn't want to get too picky with that.
But I mean, you know, if we want to sit there and nitpick, if you look around the major leagues at base, you know, all the major league teams, and look at some of the play, you know what? This is what you're seeing across the league.
Hold it. They just came up out of spring training. You practice a lot of this stuff. Some of it hasn't sunk in.
Well, here's the thing. You're playing in 70 and 80 degree temperatures in either Arizona or in Florida, okay? Now it's 35 degrees and you're sitting
and
there
you're
with your teeth
up.
Chattering. And the wind is blowing and it's a bit unforgiving. And you know what? So things happen. So I'm not going to get too excited about it. Tomorrow night, Jameson Taillon takes the hill again. And I think the Pirates are going to come on top. And yesterday, to be honest with you, to me, looked like a typical Pirates-Cardinals game. The Pirates and the Cardinals always seem to be
ebbs and flows.
Yeah, you know,
they score.
1 year, one team wins 10, the other one wins 9. The next year, one wins 10. You know, it goes back and forth. And the Cardinals are one of the better-run organizations in baseball.
Sure.
And they've got a lot more money.
I just had the feeling watching the game after Archer was out that we were going to peter it away. A little run here, a little run there. And sure enough, that's what happened. You got to give them credit because they didn't give up.
So an opinion for you, Al.
Yeah.
There was some criticism of Chris Archer and the enthusiasm he was showing after making big pitches on a game. And specifically Rick Sutcliffe of ESPN was talking badly about Chris Archer. And, you know, I got to tell you, the last inning he pitched, the fifth inning, he had runners on base. He has literally the Cardinals' two best hitters in Matt Carpenter and Paul Goldschmidt back-to-back, and he strikes both of them out to end the inning. And I'm going to tell you something. I don't have a problem with Chris Archer's enthusiasm because his enthusiasm is just his joy for the game and competing at a high level and making a pitch in a clutch situation.
Sure.
He wasn't showing up. The people that he was playing against.
And if people take it that way, then that's their problem. Just like if somebody gloats going around the base path after knocking a home run after him. Guess what? In a sense, they're proud of what they did, hitting his best pitch out of the ballpark.
As long, you know,
I'm not going to go crazy with that either.
Well, there is. You know, showing some appreciation for coming through in a big moment.
Yeah.
And then they're showing up, you know, your opponent. You got it. There's a fine line there.
There's a line.
I think bat flips are a bit, you know, are a bit much.
Yeah.
But, you know, I mean, we've got a younger generation. And, hey, if they want to show their enthusiasm and, you know, Chris Archer is a great role model does so much for the community. But, you know, to see the enjoyment that he gets in the game, that's going to inspire young kids to want to play the game of baseball.
Sure.
Okay, and that's really
he's adding to the excitement
key.
Of it.
Yeah.
Let alone what he accomplished.
So,
he did that.
Purpose. I did not have a problem with him doing that. And I'm old school when it comes to baseball rules. I am definitely I'm not a fan of the DH.
Yeah.
I'm a very firm believer that for you to be on the 25-man roster, you need to be able to play a position in the field.
Sure.
Okay? And if you don't play a position in the field, you should not get a chance to bat.
I second that emotion.
Okay? So, I mean, I love the National League game. I hope they never change it. That's just...
Me too.
...the way I'm always going to feel. But, the players' union is not going to allow, because what does the DH do? It allows aging players to continue to play
another
a game
5 years.
That they got no business playing anyhow. And a younger player who could get a chance to become a star, it's holding him down. So I think that roster spot, I think they should go with no DH in both leagues. But
I'm with you on that. And for Archer to lay down that perfect bunt.
I
was amazed at that.
You know, it's the little things in baseball that I think make all the difference in the world. You know, the strategy that's involved with,
sure.
you know, with everything. And you don't see that in the American League. They're swinging for the fences every time. And that's usually you're going to find most of your strikeout kings and home run hitters in the American League. But, you know, is it a better product? I don't think so.
No.
I don't think so. So, you know, right now, before no panic buttons being pressed here.
162 games for a reason.
Yeah, we got 159 left, okay? And they're going to wash this one off from yesterday. They're going to bounce back tomorrow night, and raise the Jolly Roger. That's my prediction.
Whoa.
So now we, we've gotten through with a quick rundown of the Pirates. There's some areas that they do need some improvement in. But,
sure.
I mean, you look across baseball, or I guess there's not a team that you can say, with the exception of the Phillies and maybe the Milwaukee Brewers. They started out hot. Christian Yelich hit home runs in his first four games.
Yeah.
Paul Goldschmidt, first baseman, he hit... He hit four home runs prior to yesterday's game in the first four games. And Chris Archer did a pretty good job of keeping him he's got a heck of a bat. He's quite an acquisition. And, you know, so we move on from there. So yeah. Next we got tonight, Penguins, Red Wings in Detroit. Penguins win. They've sewn clinch. Up a playoff spot. Clinch a playoff spot for the 12th year in a row. They could also clinch the spot.
Somebody has to lose.
So. I believe Montreal.
Yeah.
Or
yeah, Montreal,
Carolina.
Yeah.
You know, one of those two. But, you know, so the Penguins are getting ready. But here's the perplexing point I have. Evgeny Malkin has said is supposed to be ready to play by the playoffs. The big question marks we have right now, our top two defensemen are out. Ryan Dumoulin's out tonight. Somehow he was injured.
23 minutes he put in the other game.
Sunday
he
night.
Led everybody in minutes. How'd he get hurt?
You know, and then what is going on with Chris Letang? What kind of injury do we have? We don't know. We don't know when he's going to be back. You know, Matt Murray has been playing lights out.
Yeah.
Matt
this
Murray will be in Nate's.
Yeah,
he's going to be in the Nets tonight. And, you know, once we do wrap up the playoff spot, you know, do you keep playing Matt Murray so that he keeps his edge? Or do you protect him and rest him for the playoffs?
I play him.
You know, and the same question would remain for Sid. You know, do you want to risk having somebody take a run at him saying, I'm going to make sure because this is what happens in hockey. And it's what's always happened in hockey.
Play him.
Play him, you know,
play
and
him,
I know Sid in his heart would probably want to play, but a lot of injuries on the Penguins roster right now.
What they overcame in injuries just in March alone is just unbelievable to have the record that they did.
Yeah, to be still in contention
yeah.
because they very easily could have
dropped right out of it.
Yeah, but that shows you the heart of a champion.
And know? It shows what Rutherford and the team has done. To have the layers of players.
Yeah, and Sullivan, you know, obviously I think, you know, this is probably his best coaching job. Because
what he's had to do.
Because he has not, I don't think he's had the same lines together two shifts in a row all season. He has been playing, you know, he's been playing, juggle the lineups.
This one out, this one in,
yeah.
Sure.
It's hard to say what he's going to do.
Up, like we said, some of these new players had to get adjusted to playing the game here, first of all, let alone with new players. And it's a tough thing. But they have done it, so, you know, it's pretty good.
So we've got, you know, now what else is going on in sports? Well, we have the Final Four this weekend.
Yeah.
Is the Masters this week or
yes,
next?
Yes, I think Masters is this weekend.
Masters week.
Yeah.
And, you know, watching golf on TV is like watching fungus grow in your refrigerator. But there are a few tournaments a year that will garner my interest.
Yeah,
and the
it.
Masters being one of them, it's one of the most...
It's that green jacket you like.
...picturesque golf courses. Well, being in the lawn care industry, a course is meticulously manicured as Augusta National. It is a beauty to see.
Sure.
And on another note, hey, I was first day out down at PNC Park yesterday. They did a good job on the field. It had good color.
Didn't meet your expectations.
Yeah, yeah. No, I when I walked in and I was like, my wife.
They did well.
Yeah, I'm like, they probably fertilized this 2 or 3 weeks ago, is what I told my wife.
For sure.
Yeah, the color was kicking. The color
sure.
was kicking.
They do some work on that field at all times.
Oh, I know. You know, the interesting thing I saw that when I was down at Pirate Fest in January, they had two straw coyotes, one in left center field and one in right center field. And I looked, and people were like, what are those? I said, they look like coyotes. They said, what are they there for? I said, I bet you they're there to scare away geese.
Yeah.
And that's the reason why they were there, because, you know, the geese down there.
Oh.
And once you start them with a problem, they become
they
a problem.
Come.
And I'm telling you what, they make the field treacherous by their droppings.
Their droppings are
their
dangerous.
Their droppings,
yeah.
they're treacherous, to say the least. I have experience with that because we manage the... sports complex down at on Neville Island.
Yeah,
and we have to keep the geese off the lacrosse field. There's,
wow, you have fun chasing them.
No, I there's material that I can apply
oh, okay.
that encourages them to go somewhere else.
Oh, nice. Give them a little hint.
Yeah, no, don't want to let out any of my secrets.
I got you.
You don't want to let out any of my secrets.
Keep those secrets here. That's why you're in business.
So, you know, we've got Masters Golf. We've got, and then we got the Pirates and the Reds this weekend. You know, it's a two-game series against the Cardinals. And then we, after today being off with the Pirates, we give 6 days in a row, 6 games in a row.
Wow.
Yeah. So
better get ready.
Yeah, it's time to start playing baseball. But it'll be interesting to see. One of the things I saw Sunday that I thought was interesting that Clint Hurdle did, because they rained out on Saturday.
Yeah.
They moved Trevor Williams back to Sunday. And Trevor Williams, I believe, it's hard to argue that he's not the ace of the staff.
For junk that he throws, he masters it.
He masters it. But they had Joe Musgrove come in and throw 2 innings of relief on a day that he was supposed to normally pitch.
Right, he would have pitched the whole game.
So, so we've got Ty on tomorrow night.
Right.
Jordan Lyles will be pitching Thursday night. Musgrove on I think Trevor Williams on Friday,
and then
Musgrove on Saturday. Yeah. So it'll be interesting to see everybody get their turn and start the rotation in the way they got.
They can get serious.
Yeah, they can, because they do have their 5 starting pitchers together
right
now.
Right.
Jordan Lyles has been brought up as the 5th starter.
And we'll see what he has.
Mm-hmm.
Definitely. Now there's a lot of ifs. And that's what we're counting on, that some of these guys can produce, like Trevor Williams. Look at Chris Archer, had a good performance, no matter what you say. He threw a lot of pitches, but he did perform well.
Yeah, and I think
he had good stuff.
I think that as Chris Archer gets a little bit more comfortable pitching, he's got some amazing stuff. And I think one of the things that pitcher falls into a trap with, when you've got the kind of stuff that Chris Archer has, is you don't have to strike out every batter.
Yeah.
You have to trust the 8 men in the field, okay? And not be
let them make the outs for you.
And you could do that. And if you can get a guy out throwing 1 or 2 pitches as opposed to 7 or 8,
let's take it.
Because generally here's what happens with pitchers that are strikeout pitchers is, they get up 0-2. And then they start nibbling around the edges, and they get ball 1. They get ball 2. They get ball 3. And then if you don't get a call come the 4th one, you're putting a runner on base. And every time you put a runner on base, or every time you give them a free 90, okay, something bad can happen.
Yeah.
Something
bad
can happen.
Walking a guy is one of the most egregious things that can happen.
Well, or, pass balls. Like, the reason Pirates lost yesterday, twice, balls got past the catcher. They got the extra 90 feet.
You've got to be on the same page with the pitcher to throw that pitch.
Well, these are things that, the pitch that Kingham threw that lost the game for him yesterday, Cervelli was expecting a fastball. And Kingham said, I messed up. I threw a breaking ball, and he wasn't expecting. Yeah. And it broke a bit more than he wanted it to, and Cervelli wasn't prepared to get over it, and it bounced off the umpire.
Yeah, hit him right in the – can't talk about it. Mm-hmm. But, hey, thanks for watching our show. We're going to get out of here. Please stay Joey Strong.